Was there? There's not a dollar figure on that problem, is there? No, no dollar figure. No. Sorry. Above your pay grade. Okay. Should we ask the other co-authors? Is there any co-authors here? Okay. Time for our last problem. We have Tom Viering. Take it away.
Thank you, Jack. Hi, my name is Tom Viering. I will be presenting this open problem, which we call the monotonicity of learning. And I proposed this together with Alexander Meij and my supervisor, Marco Loog, from TU Delft. So in this open problem, we're in the general setting of learning, or the statistical learning setting. So we have an unknown distribution D over a particular domain Z. We have a training set, Sn, of size n, iid sampled from this unknown distribution. And we have a hypothesis set, H. We have a loss function, L. And we have a learner, A. For example, you could think about just empirical risk minimization, or a regularized algorithm could also be applied to this setting. And as usual, the goal is to minimize the risk, Rd, of the returned hypothesis of your algorithm. So in this setting, we ask a seemingly very simple question, and that is, does a bigger sample size improve generalization? And if you think about it, if you get some extra data, you might be unlucky, right? You might get an outlier, so in that case, your performance might decrease. So we want to avoid that, so that is why we ask this question in expectation. So in expectation over all possible training sets, will your performance improve? So more formally, given a specific learner A, a domain Z, does the following hold for all N and distributions D? So in this inequality on the left-hand side, we have the learner trained on N plus one samples in expectation over all possible training sets. So that's the risk over there. And on the right-hand side, we have the learner trained on N samples in expectation over all possible samples. So does the risk really decrease if we get additional samples? So we call this property monotonicity of a learner. And you can also visualize this property. So here on the y-axis, we have the expected risk. And on the x-axis, we have the sample size. And so if this property holds, you will see that the risk will really monotonically decrease. And if you think about generalization bounds, usually bounds, they are usually monotonically decreasing, but just that the bound monotonically decreases does not mean that the risk will really, in practice, monotonically decrease. So, why are we proposing this open problem? Why is it interesting? Well, actually, we talked to many people about this problem, and actually, many people believe that this property really holds, the monotone property, but actually, in the next few slides, I will have an example where we clearly show that this is not the case. So, everyone thinks it's true, but it's not really the case, so let's try to prove it. And of course, it's a very nice property, right? It is a very natural property that you would want your learner to satisfy, basically. A second reason is in other fields, for example, in semi-supervised learning, and it's a different setting, there you want usually, if you add unlabeled data, that your performance will improve. But actually, it's possible that your performance, in some cases, gets worse. So here the question is, does unlabeled data improve your performance? But this question is actually more difficult than the question we ask here. So we propose, maybe first let's look at this simpler question. What do we really know about if we increase the size of your labeled data set? Does performance then always improve? Finally, interestingly, in an older open problem, there it was argued that if your learner is risk monotone, this can actually imply faster rates for density estimation. Okay, so now I will show some graphs of the counterexample. So we have found a distribution. Actually, it's a very simple one-dimensional distribution for a regression setting. And So we train a regressor ordinary least squares. So you use empirical risk minimization with the L2 loss. And actually, as you can see in this graph, the more data you get, actually the worse your risk gets. Your expected risk is just increasing. And okay, so at first we thought, okay, maybe we're just overfitting in the classical sense. So we added a regularizer. But as you can see, surprisingly, sometimes regularization helps, but in other cases, actually, it can get worse. And we have this very surprising behavior where the risk first decreases, then increases, and decreases again. So it's very non-monotone. And then, even more surprisingly, if you do if you take the same distribution and you use L1 as a loss function, and you train your regressor, you can observe this kind of behavior. So this is even more surprising to us. And so we want to understand this. And I can understand you might be a bit skeptical, but actually the computations in this example are so simple, you can do them in closed form analytically. So they are definitely not an artifact of some kind of sampling error or something like this. So to wrap up, what is really the open problem about? So we want to understand why and when does this non-monotone behavior occur. So we have the example, but we don't really understand why this is happening. So it would be great if we can understand that. And of course, we want to guarantee somehow that our learners are monotone. So can we maybe come up with a specific learning strategy that results in a monotone learner? And not a trivial one, like always return a constant hypothesis, because this is not very interesting. But can we have more elegant strategies? It might be also possible that the distribution we are looking at is just too nasty. So maybe we should figure out what kind of distributional assumptions are good that exclude this kind of behavior. And finally, it might be the case that the sample size just needs to be much larger, but then it would be interesting to know at what sample size do learners really become monotone. So finally, if you're interested in the distribution that I showed, you can come and find me and I will explain exactly how the distribution looks like. But it is a very, very simple example. Thank you.
So unfortunately, we're out of time, and the next session starts right now. But let's just thank all of the speakers one more time.